This is Kim Newlove, host of the Pharmacist Voice podcast. Today kicks off my four-part PGX Pharmacist series. What is a PGX Pharmacist, you may ask? In my own words, a PGX Pharmacist is someone who has formal education in pharmacogenomics and either helps patients or helps other healthcare professionals with their pharmacogenomics knowledge. Today's episode is an interview with Dan Krinsky. Then, the next three interviews will be with some women in the pharmacogenomics space. February 11th, 2022, will be an interview with Sue Paul. February 25th is an interview with Miriam S. Yassin. And Dr. Jamie Wilkie will be on the podcast March 11th. If you haven't heard of Miriam S. Yassin, that's because she graduates with her PharmD this spring. She's also earning a master's degree in pharmacogenomics. This is a great opportunity to share with you what students are learning about pharmacogenomics in pharmacy school today. I have been out of school for 20 years, and I'll tell you, times have changed. I had to learn about pharmacogenomics from CEs and conferences and networking. PGX didn't exist in the 90s and early 2000s when I was in school. One thing's for sure, though, PGX is here to stay. I realize this may be your first time listening to this podcast, so if you're new to the show, welcome. A little bit about me. My name is Kim Newlove, and I'm a pharmacist by training, but I made a career transition to voice actor and podcast host. I was inspired by my nonverbal teenaged son with autism to combine my identity as a pharmacist with my speaking voice and launch my voiceover business, The Pharmacist Voice, in 2017. My son Craig helped me realize the power of having a voice and using it. Among other things, I narrate audiobooks for women pharmacist authors, and I provide narration for projects such as e-learning projects and explainer videos. Each week, I alternate solo podcast episodes and interview shows. The solo shows are about some aspect of being a pharmacist, a voice actor, a pharmacist podcaster, or my career transition from pharmacist to voice actor and podcast host. My interview shows feature a variety of people who use their voices to advocate for something, educate in some way, or entertain so that you are inspired to use your voice too. This is episode 133, and you can find the show notes with links to anything mentioned today on my website, thepharmacistvoice.com. As I mentioned earlier, my guest today is Dan Krinsky. During our conversation, you'll hear a great chronological progression of Dan's career, but I want to share a brief bio here first. Dan Krinsky is an entrepreneur and pharmacist who is passionate about advancing patient care and the pharmacy profession. He recently started two businesses whose respective missions and visions are focused on each of these areas. The first business, PGX 101, is directed towards educating healthcare providers in the area of pharmacogenomics and personalized medicine. The second business, Educare for You, is focused on patient, student, and healthcare provider education and enhancing patient care. Mr. Krinsky is currently an adjunct professor at the Leecom College of Pharmacy, serving as a course director, lecturer, and student advisor. Mr. Krinsky's areas of expertise include community pharmacy practice, drug information, patient counseling and education, OTCs, natural products, and developing and implementing medication therapy and disease state management programs. As you listen to my interview with Dan, you'll hear how he has explored a number of different opportunities in the pharmacy profession and is a passionate teacher. As I mentioned earlier, pharmacogenomics wasn't around when Dan and I went to school. You'll hear how Dan got into PGX later in his career and has a lot of passion for it. Toward the end of our conversation, Dan talks about his mission work in Honduras and also gives advice to pharmacist dads listening to our conversation. If you're interested in how to get into PGX, you are going to love this interview. In fact, Check the show notes for a link to some PGX training coming up in the month of February 2022. It's February 26th and 27th. If you're not interested in PGX, that's fine. You will still be inspired to use your voice when you hear the many ways Dan has used his. Without further ado, here's my conversation with Dan Krinsky. Hi, Dan. Welcome to the Pharmacist Voice Podcast. How are you?
Great, Kim. Thanks very much. I appreciate you having me.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I think the first time we ever met was at the Medipreneurs Conference in Asheville, North Carolina in 2018. Is that right?
Yes, it is. Mm-hmm.
And it is such a small world that we realized we have a mutual acquaintance, don't we?
Yes, we do. Folks I've known since I was in pharmacy school just a few years ago.
Yeah, it was just a couple years ago for me too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No, but the acquaintance would be my Uncle Tom. And I couldn't believe that we were sitting there at a table talking. And I told you I went to the University of Toledo and I was a Titkemeyer. That's my maiden name. And you said, I know a Titkemeyer. Is it Tom? And Tom and Janet, those are my aunt and uncle who are both pharmacists. And you said, yes. So how do you know my Uncle Tom again?
So I trained at the St. Vincent Hospital in Toledo, Ohio, when I was in pharmacy school. And when I was an intern there, we had a chance to interact with all the pharmacists. And two of my favorite pharmacists were Tom and Janet. In fact, I don't think that they were married at the time that I first met them. And obviously, since then, we've all progressed through our lives and they have lots of grandkids now. And now I've had a chance to meet one of their nieces and get to know you, which is wonderful.
I remember once upon a time, Uncle Tom, when I interviewed him for the podcast, he's in episode 3. He said, I have an old intern that you should definitely interview. And at the time, I didn't accept referrals. I was just getting started. But then I met you and I realized you're the guy.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yes. I don't think he mentioned it on the podcast, but I remember afterwards him saying, you know, you should really interview one of my old interns. And I'm like, I don't even know how that works, but whatever.
There were a few of us that worked there together and are still best of friends to this day. And I will credit Tom and Janet for some of the work ethic I developed as a pharmacist and just the way they approached the business end of it. And then the people, the person, looking at the individuals and treating people with respect and all those things. So I really admired what they did. And I've carried that with me to this day.
I think you turned out pretty great.
Well, thank you. I work in progress, right? Aren't we all works in progress?
I know. Well, we have to continue to grow. Otherwise, what's the point, right?
Exactly. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, I brought you on the show today because you are what I call a PGX pharmacist, and you're part of my PGX pharmacist series. And I know that you have done so many things with your voice as a pharmacist, like being an expert witness and all kinds of things that not every pharmacist does. So uh-huh. I would love to talk about not just your being a PGX pharmacist, but also some of those other things too. So
sure.
Yes, let's dive in. This is going to be cool.
Okay. Well, I guess I can go back to when I first got interested in the profession. If we want to start there and just kind of progress through what's happened in my career since I met my dad's best friend. My dad's best friend was a community pharmacist, and I was interested in getting involved in healthcare and wanted to own my own business. And so I decided to go to pharmacy school, went to the University of Toledo, and at graduation, I had two options. One option was I wanted to go to Vermont and buy some land and raise golden retrievers and have my own business. The other option was something that one of my professors at Toledo suggested, and that is go to graduate school, get your education now, don't get reliant on the paycheck, get yourself prepared for a career that's going to put you in a position that you will be in a much more competitive advantage with a graduate degree. And at the time, Toledo did not offer the PharmD program, but they had a master's program. So I kind of created my own combination master's program with a lot of research and teaching components to it. And spent 3 years at Toledo in graduate school and spent a year coordinating the internal medicine rotation for the undergraduate students. Spent a year in the pediatric department coordinating the rotation for the undergraduate students. and then spent a year doing clinical research in pharmacokinetics. I got my master's degree, got all the experience in kinetics, got some experience in education. And then what do I do with that? Well, I took a position in North Carolina at a place called Gaston Memorial Hospital. And the goal was to have myself and a few other new pharmacists come in and develop clinical services. Well, through a series of different circumstances, that did not work out very well. And I ended up staffing second and third shift and was very frustrated because I was not using my recent education and experience. Mm-hmm. This is back before the internet, and to find a new job, you had to look in the back of the American Journal of Hospital Pharmacists at the time, AJHP, where they had all the want ads. Found a position as the clinical coordinator for the pharmacokinetics service at University of Alabama Hospital in Birmingham. Well, it was kinetics, but it was also a position that I felt I was not even close to being qualified for because I had very little experience outside of my graduate work. But I was so frustrated in my position, I said, you know what, I'll just take a day off of work just to get away from work. I'll apply, do the interview, and we'll see what happens. If it works out, great. If not, I'll find something else. Well, lo and behold, it worked out. The service was fairly new, and they had a part-time pharmacist and a resident covering the service until they could hire somebody new. So I joined the drug resource team. They had drug information pharmacists. They had an investigational drug pharmacist, and I was the coordinator of the kinetic service. And so we grew that from seeing 15 patients a month to seeing about 50 patients a day.
Wow.
And we were automatic consults for all the ICU patients. It was a primary referral center in the Southeast for burn patients. We were automatic consults on them. All the transplant patients, it was an incredible experience. I taught at Auburn University. The PharmD students had to rotate. Through my service, I had a kinetics resident. We had four, what would be now called PGY1 residents, rotate through kinetics. We got all the satellite pharmacists trained in kinetics. It was an unbelievable experience. The challenge was I was on call all the time.
Oh, wow. Did you have a family at the time?
Not quite yet, no. So it started before I got married and then continued on until we'd had our first child. So we had Brian, who was a couple of years old. And again, I was on call 12 out of 14 days, 24/7. And we get paged, patients will come out of surgery and the surgical resident would call me and say, hey, put this patient on antibiotics. And that was it. So it was up to me to determine what medications, dosing, frequency, monitoring, and I'd be the one to call in the ID consults a lot of times. And so it was an incredible experience, but the stress and the time commitment was just getting to the point where it just wasn't manageable. So we made a family decision for a number of reasons to move back to Ohio. And my position back in Ohio was with Kaiser. So I worked for Kaiser Permanente for a couple of years. And they had a pretty significant presence here in Northeast Ohio. We had 11 different facilities in different communities in the Akron-Cleveland area. And I was on the drug information team, P&T committee, and developed disease management programs for Kaiser. And did a lot of collaboration with pulmonologists, pediatricians, ophthalmologists, dermatologists, and just had a lot of fun doing that. I was in charge of the NCQA reviews, which was their quality reviews that were required each year. And it was just an unbelievable experience. That was where I got my first taste of Lexicomp. And we'll revisit Lexicomp a number of times throughout my career. So Lexicomp did Kaiser's formulary. And as it turns out, our Lexicomp rep from Northeast Ohio lived in my neighborhood. Again, it's the whole small world thing. So I met Brian. We got to know each other very well. Kaiser did our formulary, and that worked out fine. When I was at Kaiser, I got a phone call from a former colleague of mine at Toledo who said, we're looking for somebody who might be able to step into a new position that Ohio Northern University College of Pharmacy is putting together. So we met and talked about it. He said, colleges of pharmacy have typically had shared positions with inpatients, hospital pharmacists and ambulatory care, but not in the community setting. And Ohio Northern wants to partner with a small chain pharmacy, which was Richmond Pharmacies based in Wadsworth, Ohio. And they had some challenges because some of the big chains were moving in right near their pharmacies. And they were very family-oriented business. They were worried about losing business. And they knew that they had to do something to continue to elevate their level of practice. So they went to Northern, they collaborated and said, well, what if we got a pharmacist to teach at Northern and then also help us develop programs here at Richmond's? Folks at Northern said, sounds like a great idea. So they asked me if I'd be interested. I interviewed with the folks at Richmond's, and what was fascinating was one of the owners of Richmond Pharmacies had a small plane. And it's about a 2.5 hour drive from Wadsworth to Ada, Ohio, where Ohio Northern is located. So we didn't drive. We went in his small plane. He flew us to the Bluffton Community Airport and then were picked up by the Northern faculty. And then I interviewed that day on the campus at Ohio Northern in Ada.
That's quite an impression he made, I'm sure.
Yes. it was pretty interesting to have five of us crammed in this small private plane, all dressed in our suits.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And I never flown in a small plane and landed in a small plane. My only other experience in a small plane was when I went skydiving.
Oh, I've been in small planes on the islands here. You know, like Kelly's Island, Bay Island. Those are small puddle jumpers too. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was a really unique experience. So they decided they wanted to bring me on board. So I was actually the first person in the country to have a shared position with a college of pharmacy and a community pharmacy. We had no idea what we were going to do, how we were going to do it, but they basically said, here's your budget. Let's have some fun.
Dan, I got to stop you for a second. What year was this? It's got to be the 90s, right?
No, this was in 1994.
Okay. Because I remember things like this were just starting when I entered pharmacy school in 1996. Sorry to interrupt you, but I just wanted to get a little timeline there.
Yeah. So I left Alabama in 1991, worked for Kaiser from 91 to 94, and then started at Richmond's and Northern in 94.
Got it.
And one of the first things we did was look at remodeling pharmacies to get the pharmacists closer to the patients. They were very interested in establishing even a greater community presence, and they wanted to be able to have the pharmacist, and was a lot of the owners that worked in the stores, to continue to interact with the patients and to grow the business. And so we did remodels, we did staff education, we developed disease management and MTM before it was MTM, and did some amazing things. We got involved in natural products. I was involved in helping to select manufacturers that we would bring in and do tons of education of our staff and associates and the community to let them know that, you know, we're going to get into this business, but we're going to do it the right way. And Richmond's did everything the right way. They were a phenomenal organization to work with. I owe them so much because of what I've been able to experience in my career, because of what they let me do. And that's kind of where the name of my current business came from, was we decided to establish a specific identity for the work that we were doing in that area. So we came up with the term Educare. So that was one of the business units at Richmond's, and it focused on education and patient care. That's where the Educare name came from.
I like it.
And yeah, it seemed to resonate really well with the community. We did branding, did lots of marketing. It was really a wonderful experience. We did a lot of store remodels. We put consultation rooms in some of the stores. You know, we'd mount the blood pressure cuff on the wall and make it look like a physician's office. But for pharmacists, and we had patients coming in paying cash for the work that we were doing for them. We had a couple of contracts with small businesses in some of our communities. But one of the challenges was we were too far ahead of the curve. We developed all these services, but we couldn't develop the revenue stream. And that was obviously very frustrating to the organization.
Yeah.
So while I was at Richmond's and we got into natural products, Lexicomp kind of found out about that. And I had a good relationship with the folks at Lexicomp through the formulary work. And they contacted me and said, hey, would you be interested in writing a couple of books for us? Said, what do you mean? Well, we have no content on supplements and herbs and natural products. And this is a growing industry, and we need to be able to provide evidence-based information to clinicians to help them understand what this is all about. And we'd like you to be a part of that. Okay, let's see what we can do. So I put together a team of folks and we authored two books for Lexicomp on natural products. One was called The Natural Therapeutics Pocket Guide and the other was The Drug Nutrient Depletion Handbook. And they were pretty popular with Lexicomp because, again, it was at a time when natural products was growing as an industry. And when Lexicomp went primarily electronic, they were able to offer that same content through the handheld devices and online. So it worked out very well. And that gave me a little bit more experience working with the folks at Lexicomp. So in around year 2000 or so, Ritzmann's was struggling to support our business unit that wasn't generating a ton of revenue, but was generating a lot of secondary revenue through patient loyalty programs and things like that, but just kind of decided to part ways amicably because I didn't want them to be in a position where they felt like they had to eliminate my position. So I said, you know, I'll just start seeing what's out there and see if we can, part ways and still, be close contacts and still collaborate on things and all that. So Lexicomp called and said, we have a need. We have a ton of people in the sales department and the marketing department that have no experience in healthcare. And they're going out and they're trying to sell this really detailed clinical content and these different applications. We need somebody to educate our sales and marketing team, be the conduit between the clinical team and our authors and other clinical folks with the sales and marketing team. We also want somebody to head up our academic sales team. And I was involved in business partnering. I was the primary contact with Lexicomp with their relationship with APHA and UpToDate and a few other business partners. General Electric ended up licensing our content at Lexicomp. So again, it was an amazing opportunity. I knew the owner, Bob Kirscher. I knew some of the pharmacists that worked there that had also been pharmacists as inpatients in shared positions with Northern. So that whole little community that we had, we've all stuck together over the years. It's a phenomenal group of people, and we still work together to this day. Still best of friends. Our kids are best friends. I'll tell you about that in just a second. But so Lexicomp said, would you like to join the team? And, it was a perfect time because of what was going on at Ritzmann's. And I hated to leave that environment, but I just knew that it wasn't sustainable at the time. So I joined the Lexicomp team. Initially, I was in charge of the academic sales team and then developing education programs for our staff. It morphed into a ton of work with, like I said, business partnering, marketing, educating the sales team, going on sales calls, doing a ton of trade shows. I ended up going to Singapore for 8 days to do the FIP conference and to work with some of the hospitals in Singapore to get them to license our content. In fact, I got home from Singapore 2 days before 9/11.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So it was pretty tight timing there. Mm-hmm. So Lexicomp was a phenomenal experience. And I was there for about 7 years. And I got approached by somebody that used to work with me when he was at NACDS. So when I was with Ritzmann's in Northern, NACDS found out about this being the first shared position, developing clinical programs, community pharmacy, and they could develop kind of a roadshow. So they worked with me and some other folks at Ritzmann's to take this message that these shared positions need to be developed more out to the larger chains. And so I would go do talks at NACDS conferences. And they always sent us to very nice places. And I'd work with the folks at NACDS. I'd go to their offices in Alexandria, Virginia, a few times a year. And we'd just brainstorm about how do we help colleges of pharmacy and community pharmacy organizations develop a business plan to create more positions like mine. So I think we went from one at the time back in 94. And now I think there's over 300 in play right now with different organizations. So it has grown in a way that they were hoping that it was going to grow. So I got to know a lot of folks at NECDS. So one of my contacts there ended up going to work for Marixa. Marixa was one of the first players in the MTM space. Mm-hmm. He said, you have a lot of experience in drug information and patient care. And he went down this list and he said, we need somebody to come in and develop a website for consumers that has drug information they can understand that supplements the consult that the pharmacist is providing to them. So after the pharmacist talks to them about their medication, where do they go for additional information? We need a quality resource that's internal that you can develop and then maintain that people can access. So we developed this Rx Wiki website that had a number of contributors to the content, but I oversaw the content development and all that. And neat idea. I could work from home, which was great. I'd go to their offices, which was were also in Alexandria, once or twice a month for meetings and things like that. That was fine until 2 weeks before Christmas in 2007, I think, when they called and said, your business unit's been eliminated.
Oh, you got downsized.
I knew they were having a board meeting that weekend and we were supposed to have a conference call at 10 o'clock that Monday morning to talk about what the next steps were. So at 9 o'clock, the CEO called and Don said, hey, Dan, the board met and they're looking at the finances and said, we can't afford to keep your business unit anymore. I said, okay.
Sorry to hear that.
So at 10 o'clock that morning, I was officially unemployed. So what do you do, right? So then you use your network and your knowledge and all that. So they rehired me as a consultant for a few months to bridge the gap to determine what they wanted to do with the website. So during that time, I got a call from somebody I knew that used to work at Ohio State that was at the time at NeoMed. And she said, you know, we're developing this college of pharmacy. We're in our first year now. We need to have some shared faculty. Do you know anybody? She said, do you know anybody who might be interested in a shared position with a college of pharmacy and a local community pharmacy?
That sounds like something you might like, Dan.
So you talk about using your voice. Well, I didn't use my voice at all. I just let the line go dead silent for 30 seconds. She said, hey, are you still there? Are you still there? I said, your timing could not be any better. I said, you know, I'm looking for a position. I've got experience. And she just was elated. So I ended up getting that position and it was with NeoMed and Giant Eagle. And did that for 10 years. And then I worked just at NeoMed for a year. And then my position there was eliminated. And then I was at that point in time where, you know, do I retire? Do I semi-retire? What do I do? And, you know, I sat down and talked to some folks and said, I just still have too much passion for the profession. And I still have too much I want to give back to the profession. And so I started my new business, which is called Educare for You. Which is a take on the Educare business that we had at Ritzman's a while back. And then Sue and I had started the PGX 101 business back in 2018. And so now I'm working within those two businesses to just do whatever I can to advance the profession. And, you know, the PGX business has been incredible because I used to do kinetics and I saw the opportunities that pharmacokinetics provided to pharmacists to kind of individualize drug therapy for patients. But then when I found out about genetics, you know, Sue and I went to the first training session that Test to Learn had for train the trainers for pharmacists to be able to teach others on the whole science of pharmacogenomics. And I was sent to that conference to come back to the university to develop a pharmacogenomics course. And little did I know that even though I developed an elective in pharmacogenomics and we helped to incorporate pharmacogenomics into some of the therapeutics modules, that the real benefit of that attending that conference was to meet Sue and some others, but primarily to meet Sue and then to set up this business to, again, spread the word of the value of how pharmacogenomics can, you know, increase our, you know, benefit and worth in the profession, but more importantly, increase the care we provide to our patients.
Mm-hmm. That's an excellent mission too.
I've always felt that I owe the profession so much because it's given so much to me. And I want to give back in any way I possibly can. And education to me is one way that you can give back and kind of pay it forward. So I do whatever I can in whatever ways possible to kind of spread the word about the value of education, whether it's one-on-one with patients in a community pharmacy or in a group setting, at a conference, or whether it's through this type of medium with a podcast. There's so much value in education and just helping people to better understand opportunities and ways to make people feel better. And I think in our profession, we kind of lose sight of the opportunity we have to just make people feel better. It doesn't necessarily mean dispensing a drug. You know, a lot of your focus is on using our voice. And I think it's important for us to recognize that sometimes a silent voice can have so much meaning because patients really don't get anybody to listen to them anymore. And if we can just be a sounding board for these people, I think that allows us to use our voice more effectively and more efficiently if we take time to listen to people's concerns and ideas. So that's kind of my philosophy.
Oh, well said. You have one mouth and two ears. Why not use those ears, right?
That's what my mom always told me. Yeah. Sometimes you just need to shut up.
Well, when we do shut up, entire conversations happen, right? You know, if I hadn't sat here and listened to everything you just told me, I wouldn't have learned more than I already knew, let me just say. I've known you for a few years, but now I know more.
A lot's been going on. And again, I have so much to be thankful for, and I've been so blessed in this profession. You know, there's a lot of discussion now about, you know, whether we would recommend this profession to students. You know, is this something we'd recommend students pursue? And because of what's happening in our industry with a lot of the frustration the community pharmacists are feeling, the workload, lack of staffing, you know, decreased salaries, whatever those things are that people are hearing about, when it comes right down to it, we are still the most accessible healthcare provider. We are still the most knowledgeable on drug therapies and ways that we can use drug therapies and even deprescribe to help people feel better. And I like to focus more on, you know, we talk about improving outcomes, but our definition of improving outcomes might not be the same as a patient's definition of improving outcomes. And I think it's important to have that conversation to find out, what is it you want? You know, you're taking this medication for whatever the condition, what is it you want from this? And I don't think we really take the time to ask those questions, because I don't think that we want to take the time to listen to their answers, which is really, it's sad. But if we're not there to help people feel better, then what's the point, right? I mean, we dispense, 4 billion prescriptions a year as an industry? And what percent of those prescriptions actually lead to an improved quality of life? I don't know what the answer is, but I know it's not, probably not even 50%. So I think just being accessible gives us the responsibility to listen to people and try and help them in whatever way possible.
And get on the same page with them, as you just said, because if what we see and what they want are not the same thing, then we can't move forward, can we?
Exactly. Exactly.
How many times does a patient not fill a prescription because they're not on the same page with the doctor? They come to us with a prescription, and when they say they want to fill it, we think we're on the same page with them. We have the drugs. Sure, we can fill that for you. We can tell you how to take it, and we can counsel you on how to use it and what to expect. But if you're not on the same page with us about actually taking it, that's a problem.
Exactly. I had a really eye-opening experience with a couple of students. So I used to do home visits. And home visits are a real eye-opening experience. They're such a great way to learn so much about your patients. And we had a med list, and I had talked to this individual on the phone a couple of times. But it was important for us to do a home visit. And she had some transportation issues. So I said, I'm more than willing to come out to the house. Is it okay if I bring a few students? And she said, that's fine. We get to the house, and before we even walked in the door, I could tell that my premonition was true, that she was a smoker. So we walk in the door, and there's a very small living space there. And in one chair is her daughter, and the other chair is her son. Between them is a table that has an ashtray piled high with cigarette butts. Mm-hmm. And they each have their own 2-liter bottle of Mountain Dew. Okay. And they're probably both 50 to 80 pounds overweight. So she greets us at the door, and she takes us into the little kitchen area where we're going to sit down and talk about her medications. And she's probably 100 pounds overweight. She's got her own ashtray. Stacked on the table in the kitchen are cases of sugared soda, sugared pop, bags of chips, and just it's that traditional environment that you see that leads to really unhealthy behaviors. So we're sitting down. I could tell my students are just so wide-eyed. Like, oh my God, what? There's so much we need to have them do. And now that's running through their minds. So we sit down, we go through the med list, and I have some questions, and you know, she's responding to the questions, giving me some answers. And I know my students are waiting for me to say, okay, you need to stop smoking. You need to stop drinking this pot. You need to stop eating this stuff. So we sat there and I was kind of looking at my list. I looked up and I said, so what do you want? How can we help you? You know, what's your goal for today, tomorrow, a month from now? Just pick something. How can we help you? Because I've got a list that's probably 5 pages long that I can pick from. But unless it's something you want to do, that you have an interest in doing, then we're not going to succeed. And I'm here to help you. And so she sat there for a second. I don't think she was expecting that because I'm big on asking questions. My wife thinks I should have been an attorney. I love to ask questions and elicit information. So that's why I said, so what do you want? How can we help you? So I really don't know where to start. She said, there's just so much. It's overwhelming. I said, okay, I can appreciate that. I'm glad you recognize that because it's not something we're going to snap our fingers and all of a sudden tomorrow, everything's going to be fine. I said, how about if we start with, you know, trying to back off a little bit of some of the pop you're drinking because your blood sugar is 360, you know, your A1C is 18 or whatever it was. I mean, it was just, you know, off the charts. Let's try and, you know, get you to start drinking a little bit of water, maybe mix in some diet pop, and we'll take it very slow. I said, because realistically, I'd really like to have you stop smoking, but the only way that you're going to stop smoking is if all of you in the household decide that you're going to stop smoking together. So we went through a bunch of things. And over the next 6 to 8 months, we ended up getting her blood sugar down. It was below 170 pretty regularly, which was good. So we made some progress. And then they had some sort of life event and they had to move out of town. And I never did hear how things were going for her. But we did make some progress. But I think the message there, at least to my students, was you have to listen. You can't force things on people. You have to work together. You have to collaborate and do things that you feel the patient has a passion for doing. Because in your academic world as a student, you're going through this checklist saying, we got to do this, we got to do this, we got to do this, we got to do this. And in fact, that's what they said when we got back in the car. How come you didn't tell her? Do you think she would have done it? Can she quit smoking and then her son and daughter continue to smoke? What are the chances that she's going to do more than one thing at a time? She admitted it's overwhelming.
It is. What you did actually reminds me about the principles of cognitive behavioral therapy. Are you familiar with that?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a clinician that is experienced or trained in CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy. But when I was volunteering with the Wood County Opiate Task Force, now the Wood County Addiction Task Force, I learned some things about how you kind of get the patient to come up with their own plan, you know? And that I feel like is kind of what you did. And when they come up with their own plan, you didn't even tell them they need to reduce the amount of sugar they take in. You let them come up with that. And then they let you come up with a few different ways that might work for them to decrease that, like switching to diet pop, or maybe every other drink's going to be water, you know?
Right.
And then they buy into it because they agree with what you're saying. And they almost take it as, wait, now who came up with that? Was it me or Dan? You know? And they just go with it.
We used to use the same thing on rounds with physicians. One of the first things I was taught in pharmacy school before we'd go out on our rotations was present ideas in the context of it's the attending physician's idea. So, hey, Dr. Smith, don't you think that might be a good idea if we did this? Oh, yeah, it'd be a great idea. Yeah. I'm glad I thought of that. And I'd say, yeah, I'm glad you did too. We do the same thing with patients. You know, it's motivational interviewing. It's finding ways to get people motivated to take at least one action to help themselves. And then they're more invested.
Absolutely. Yes.
Yeah. So that was a fun experience.
Dan, let's talk a little bit about PGX. You had mentioned that you went to a train the trainer type of a situation to learn about PGX. What was that called and do they still offer it?
It was the Test to Learn program. It was developed in conjunction with the University of Pittsburgh and the National Association of Chain Drug Stores. And they developed the program to help get pharmacists more interested in pharmacogenomics. They saw some opportunities to have pharmacists expand their areas of practice. And University of Pittsburgh is one of the leaders nationally in PGX research and practice. And so it was a good combination, good team to put together to develop this educational program. And the program that they put together for us is something that Sue and I offer to pharmacists. It's not a train-the-trainer program, but the educational program that we offer is the Test to Learn program, which is what they developed for us. The component they added for us as part of the train-the-trainer program was 4 hours and how to deliver the program and more of, you know, how to be an instructor and an educator for the program. I think they still offer the train-the-trainer program, but I don't know that they've offered it recently. NACDS turned the entire management of the program over to the University of Pittsburgh. So now they manage the whole thing from offering the CE to updating the CE program. And so Sue and I are probably two of the more active people involved in delivering that educational program to pharmacists. And it's fun to get people to attend these and to have some of those wow moments where they see opportunities to take what they've learned in school and then take the new information and apply it to their patients that they know have struggled to get the most benefit from their medications. Now, all of a sudden, things start to click. It's, oh, well, maybe it's because they are a poor metabolizer of this or a rapid metabolizer of this enzyme, which is leading to this less than desirable outcome.
The name of the company is PGX 101, and I love the name because that's what you do. And for anybody who may be a student or a pharmacy technician who doesn't encounter pharmacogenomics on a regular basis, can you just give a baseline definition of what pharmacogenomics is?
Sure. Pharmacogenomics is the science of being able to take certain aspects of an individual's gene profile and applying that to medication. So we know, we all learned in school, the cytochrome P450 enzyme system. Well, basically, those are different genes, and we all have variants of genes based on our individual makeup. And we can take what we know about somebody's individual genetic makeup and apply it to current and future drug therapies.
Well done. Thanks, Dan. Now, somebody that wants to learn more about pharmacogenomics, how do these students usually come to you to learn more about pharmacogenomics? They're all pharmacists, of course, right? So how do they find you?
We do a lot of marketing on LinkedIn, and a lot of it's our network. You know, I've been a pharmacist for over 40 years now. Sue's been a pharmacist for 30 plus years, and we have networks through conferences like Medipreneurs and EPHA, Ohio Pharmacists Association, and again, using LinkedIn and some social media. And we've just been able to get the word out that we offer a training program to help pharmacists go from really no baseline knowledge of pharmacogenomics to be able to take what we teach them and implement it in a practice setting. And it's kind of exciting. And we get pharmacists from all areas of the country. In fact, one of our more recent programs, we had, I think it was 14 pharmacists from 10 or 11 different states. And so there's a lot of people from all over that are very interested in this. And it's very exciting to be able to offer this and to help people advance their practice and maybe come up with a side hustle or whatever they want to do.
Yeah, or a side hustle that eventually becomes a main hustle. Because
exactly
right now, I'm sure you know, Dan, there's a lot of pharmacists looking to do something else.
Yes. And I think this is going to be an important part of what we do as pharmacists in the future. So if you look at areas of growth for our profession, I think this is one area that has unlimited potential. And I'm excited about what we can do as a profession in this area to help, again, patients get the greatest benefit from whatever medications they're prescribed.
Well, thank you for using your voice in that way to educate pharmacists everywhere, apparently, about this. Now, I've got to ask some questions from a pharmacist perspective who's not educated in PGX 101. So these are questions that maybe some of the listeners might want to ask. Sure. If I were interested in joining a PGX 101 class, is it physically in person or is it online?
We used to do in-person conferences. We would meet for a Saturday and spend the 8 hours together teaching pharmacists. But now it's all virtual. Now we're using Zoom technology. So there's two components to our certificate program. First is a home study, which has 15 modules. It gives you 20 hours of CE. And actually, that gives you 12 hours of CE. I'm sorry. That gives you 12 hours of CE. And then there's the 8 hours of live programming. And we do the 8 hours of live programming over 2 days. So we do 4 hours on Saturday and 4 hours on Sunday now using Zoom technology. And as much as we love getting together with people and the whole live networking was wonderful, the next best option that we have is using technology. And thankfully, we have this technology because students and pharmacists still find it advantageous to be able to come to the training sessions, and we do have time for networking and sharing ideas and talking about things. And today's technology allows us to do that in the next best way. So we're not doing anything live at this point in person. So it's all technology, but it works out fine.
Well, we're in the middle of a pandemic. This is probably safer, wouldn't you say, Dan?
It's much safer. And, you know, we think about it, it's actually economically more advantageous because we used to have conferences in Atlanta, or then one in Savannah. We've had some in Cincinnati, wherever. And if you're not from that area, then you've got travel expenses and, you know, hotel expenses for a night or two. And that adds up. So, you know, it's one way for folks to get the same level of education and save some money, and they can invest that money into their business.
Yes. Oh, that's nice. That's nice. That's actually how I attended the annual meeting of the Ohio Pharmacists Association last year. I did it virtually instead of going there. And I must say, I saved at least $500 on hotel and food expenses.
Yep.
Speaking of money, how much does PGX 101 cost for a student to attend?
The cost is $495. And that gets you all the CE and the 8 hours of live plus the 12 hours of home study. It's all inclusive.
Okay. Hey, that sounds reasonable. That's less than what I would pay for an entire weekend of hotel, food, and conference registration just going to the annual meeting of the Ohio Pharmacists Association. Not saying it's expensive, but I mean, that's a typical conference.
And we try and frame it in the context of it's an investment. So if you really want to invest in yourself, invest in your patients, invest in your future, you have to invest in education. And after you graduate, that's just the start of your education. And if you don't stay up to date and look for new ways to enhance your practice and enhance yourself, then you're not going to go anywhere. That's, you know, that's one of the mottos that I try and discuss with each one of my students and anybody that'll be willing to listen, is never settle for the status quo, and you always have to continue to improve yourself and continue to get educated. And you know, if you settle for the status quo, then you're dead. You're not going to go anywhere.
I second that, Dan, and I have to draw a parallel to a menu at a restaurant. This is me. I don't always order off the menu, but I go in thinking about what I want to eat before I look at the menu, because a lot of times in life, people will only pick what they see. But if you go in with an idea of what it is that you want to do, you can take bits and pieces and parts from more than one place and make something work. Or you can go to the store, buy the ingredients, and make it at home when it comes to food. But with my career, I know that I have had to get performance training and business training and audio engineering training, and it's weird. And I know pharmacists, not every pharmacist wants to do what I want to do, But I had this idea in mind of what I wanted to do. And if what a student of yours wants to do is help a patient and go into their house and look at their ashtrays and their Mountain Dew bottles and their health conditions and help them, then that's what they're going to do. They're not going to go in ahead of time with this, you know, preordained menu of these are the only services that I recommend. You could pick one of these, you know? I like it when people think in the mentality of ordering off the menu, whether it's education or a restaurant.
Yeah, I think we can get pigeonholed and just kind of follow a script. And I like to think outside the box and just think creatively and, you know, what else can we do? What's next? How can we make it better? How can we make it different? What else can we do? And don't just sit and rest on our laurels and, you know, settle for MTM as an example of a way to expand our practice. You know, MTM in and of itself is fine, but I think there's so much more that we can do. And, you know, pharmacogenomics gives us tremendous opportunities to really optimize a lot of key drug therapies in the areas of cardiovascular medicine and oncology and pain management, mental health. It's huge in mental health. And there's, you know, I would suggest that the mental health crisis this country has is the most biggest. It's the biggest challenge we have. It's bigger than the pandemic. It's bigger than the opioid crisis. It's bigger than anything, because all of those are a subset of the mental health crisis I think our country faces. And if we can do a better job of prescribing medications and getting better outcomes in patients by using pharmacogenomics as a tool, then we should be doing it.
Absolutely. And if pharmacists who practice even in the community at a large chain drugstore, I know that they're struggling right now, but if they have a passion for pharmacogenomics, I don't see why they can't take your course and then take that one thing, that mental health concern, and educate themselves on how to help people in just that one specific way. Can you imagine what a difference pharmacists would make across the country if they were just helping with mental health issues at a community pharmacy setting? It would make a huge difference. So yes, for anybody listening, I would say get your PGX certification and help your patients, even if it's just with one thing. You can make a difference.
Yes, we dispense so many doses of antidepressants and antipsychotics. And how often do we, you know, ask patients, how are you doing on this medicine? Do you really feel like this medicine is providing the benefit that you're looking for? Mm-hmm. And if you look at the statistics, 30 to 70% would say, no, it's not working at all. So you find those people, and then those are the people you concentrate on. Well, maybe if you did this test, which is an easy test to do, it's a cheek swab and you get the results back within 3 to 5 days, this might help us to make you feel better. And, you know, some insurance companies are paying for the test, some aren't, but most insurance companies will do some billing for, or most labs will do billing for you for their testing. Some will prorate the cost of the test to the patient based on the reimbursement rate. So there's ways that you can get the testing cost down to a reasonable amount. And again, it's an investment in your life, because once you have the testing done, that data is good pretty much forever.
Yeah. That's a good point. Great. Now, I'm going to ask another question here. Now, if somebody goes to your PGX 101 course, do you happen to have a Facebook group for graduates?
We have a Facebook page. And what Sue and I have done, and this started last year, was create PGX 201.
What? What's that?
Yes. What's PGX 201? So we recognize that we're taking people through the certificate program and they're getting their certification in pharmacogenomics. So what do they do with it, right? I mean, we know what they tell us their goal is. When we have the program, we get everybody to kind of share with us, you know, why is this of interest to you? What do you hope to do with this once you're done? But we never had the follow through. And we started to get some feedback from some of the attendees. Hey, you know, if there's a way that we could, you know, pick your brain or whatever. And so Sue and I decided, well, let's put together PGX 201. So PGX 201 is a community that we call Beyond the Certificate. So it's a membership structure. So you join for 3 months or 12 months. And by being a member of the 201 community, we have monthly webinars, we have monthly newsletters. Sue and I are available for one-on-one consultations. We'll have PGX experts come in to talk about different areas of pharmacogenomics that we might not have been able to address in tremendous detail during their certificate program, introduce the community members to people that work for different labs, other different businesses that can support what they're trying to do. So we're just now really starting to build the 201 community. Our monthly webinars are the fourth Monday evening of every month. And we've got our next one this upcoming Monday. And that will involve somebody who can come in and talk about the role of PGX in patients with attention deficit disorder and some of the medications prescribed for that. So we're Bravo. Getting some pretty good response to that. We want to continue to grow that part of the business, because we think that not just people that have attended our certificate program, but anybody that's gotten a PGX certificate or attended a training, we want to make sure that they can utilize that. And we feel the 201 community will help them to do that and even find some business opportunities. So maybe we can pair them with an organization that's looking for pharmacists to do consultations. So that's another thing that Sue and I are looking into as well.
Very good. Yes, the whole matchmaking process, I feel like, is such an important thing. It doesn't exist right now. I know that Carol Bell down in Kentucky is working on some sort of a PGX pharmacist registry.
We're actually working with Carol very closely, and we hope to take that registry concept and really make it functional and give us the opportunity to pair people that have the training with people that want the practice experience and get them to be able to deliver consultations on a regular basis. So that's pretty exciting.
I now have the song from Fiddler on the Roof, matchmaker, matchmaker, please make me a match or whatever that is. I have that going through my head now. No, that's fantastic. Good for you. I think that that is a much needed thing, because there's some forward thinking prescribers out there who would like to hit the bullseye the first time they prescribe.
Yes. In fact, there's even payers out there that recognize that absorbing the cost of the test is an investment. The Kentucky Teachers Retirement Program, I don't know if you've heard about that. Mm-mm. They have an accountant who recognized, and I don't know, I forget how this all came about, but she recognized that pharmacogenomics is something that they should consider as a benefit for teachers retired teachers in the Kentucky plan. So they actually worked through the process and developed a new benefit that's offered to every retired teacher in the Kentucky system to take advantage of getting PGX testing done to help with their medications, because they saw a 6-to-1 or 7-to-1 ROI from the cost of the test versus reduction in emergency department visits and hospitalizations, unnecessary office visits, all those types of things. So they've actually seen direct economic benefits to offering that as a benefit for the retirees in Kentucky in their teachers program. So we're taking that model, and we need to use that model as talking points for other organizations to help them recognize that you might think of it as a cost. You might think that it's going to cost you $275 per person to have that test done. Well, yes, that's what it's going to cost you. But what you're going to get back from that investment is 4 to 10-fold that, because
savings.
The team will be able to better manage that person. They'll have fewer days missed of work. They'll miss fewer days of work because their kids, who were also dependents who were tested, are now better managed with their medication. So there's so many benefits that having this type of thing done.
Right. This reminds me so much of one of the concepts in the book. I believe it was Switch by Chip and Dan Heath. Have you ever read that?
I have not. No.
Okay. The book is all about changing when change is hard. But what they do is they talk about all these examples when a company thought it was going to cost a lot of money to do something, but somebody found what they call the bright spot, somebody who's already doing something well, and they just expand on it or they use it for a different organization. For example, this one railway didn't have enough money to fund building more railways. So they took decommissioned railways, the materials, the iron for the tracks, the wood for the whatever they're called to build the structure, and they just reused them in a different location. It cost them zero money except for the labor to build this. And you just look at something like that and you think, oh yeah, you can change, even though this change is hard.
Yep. And again, I go back to never settle for a status quo. If you don't change, then you're history, because somebody else will change. Somebody else will develop the next iteration, and they'll be better at it, and they'll grab market share. So unless you're willing to change, then you could be left out. And I don't want to be left out.
Right. The focus, though, is on the patient. And I think you said this earlier, it's all about what's in it for them. When you sit down with that person at their dinner table and they've got their Mountain Dew and their ashtrays full of burnout cigarettes, what is it that they want? And we're focusing on what it is that they want to do. And when it comes to it, this Kentucky State Teachers Retirement Organization wants to serve their people well. And if we could all think about how can we solve our people well, give them good health, but then also save ourselves money, isn't that a win all around? Let's sure do is. More of that.
Yep. You know, we're looking for ways to get creative in generating revenue in our profession.
Yes.
And we know, and we've known this for a long time, that just dispensing product is no way to make a living. So how do we use what we've been trained to do as a pharmacist, which is take care of people using our education and our training and knowledge, and apply that to patient care? And pharmacogenomics is a great way, because right now we still own this, and I think pharmacists need to own this space. You get the right training, then you can do consultations. You can generate revenue there. You know, in Ohio, we have provider status, so we can develop collaborative practice agreements. We can bill for our services and get paid at a very fair wage. So there's a lot of ways that we can generate revenue and improve the quality of life of our patients and improve the satisfaction we get every day we go to work by incorporating something like this into everything we do. And obviously, I'm a firm believer in what PGX opportunities are out there, and how we can better position more people in our profession to serve in this capacity.
PGX 101 and now PGX 201 are two great ways to get started as a pharmacist, learning and implementing those pharmacogenomics principles.
Yes. And Sue, my business partner, Sue Paul, who I guess will also be a part of this discussion on pharmacogenomics, she's phenomenal at what she does, and you'll hear more about her experiences, but she's one of the leaders nationally in knowledge of PGX and implementation in her practice setting, and being able to collaborate with other providers. And her model is fairly unique, but it's one that can be utilized for other pharmacists to kind of mirror and build into their practices where they are currently. So yeah, I'm excited that Sue will have a chance to talk to your audience and share her experiences, because they're phenomenal. And, you know, PGX 101 and 201 wouldn't be anything without the work that she's done. So I give her all the credit, and I just stay on the sidelines.
You always say that whenever you two are in the room, but I think, you know, you're very good at co-owning or co-founding the PGX 101 business, because I feel like you both contribute. And I think it's just such an equal partnership, because you're always praising one another, and it's not just good manners. You really do appreciate one another. And I love that. So yes, I am looking forward to Sue talking to this audience as well.
Yes.
Now, yes. When I asked you if you had a Facebook group for the PGX 101 course, I didn't know about the PGX 201. So, the reason I asked, though, was that often when people graduate from a program and you have some sort of a Facebook group, you get feedback. And that feedback can be used to improve a course, or, you know, when you find out what people's pain points are, you can update the you know, course with the including the answer to those pain points in it. So it sounds like you're already doing all that. And I think that's just fantastic. Again, as somebody who might be looking at this program, I just wanted to ask those questions for listeners who may have the same, you know, questions. I know this exists, but what are you doing to improve it? And it sounds like you're doing fantastic things. So keep up the good work.
Thank you. We try to add new evidence when it's available into each subsequent program that we deliver. So the core test to learn program content was developed, I guess, almost 5 years ago now. And so some of the foundational information will remain the same forever. It's like pharmacology. It just doesn't change. But there's a lot of new evidence that's available. There's new guidelines that have been published by CPIC, which is the primary organization that oversees guideline development. There's just new information, obviously, because it's healthcare and it's science, right? So new information right. will be published pretty regularly. So what Sue and I have tried to do is take the core test to learn program and enhance it with all this new information. So I think that's one of the benefits of the program that Sue and I deliver is that it's very up to date. You know, even the night before we present, I'm checking a couple of websites just to make sure there's something new. And if there is something new, we'll add a few slides in there just so that our attendees will feel like, hey, I'm up to speed on this and I'm really current on this as well, because they talked about a study that was just published, you know, last month on, you know, the role of whatever it is, CYP2D6 on this medication or whatever. So, yeah, we try and make sure that everything is up to date and current, and then we deliver that as part of our core education program.
Fantastic. If I was into PGX, this is what I would be pursuing for sure. I'd be checking out PGX 101. But you take what you do that you teach and you put it into practice in your own company. Can you tell me a little bit about the Educare for You? Is that your pharmacogenomics practice, or do you do more than pharmacogenomics?
Educare for You is a huge umbrella that involves a lot of different areas of interest that I have. So that's my umbrella company. And I do individual consultations with patients. I've got some patients that have had PGX testing done. And so we use that information to help optimize their medications and looking at supplements and, you know, their entire scope of interventions that they're looking to incorporate to help them feel better. So I do individual work with patients. Educare for You also encompasses a lot of the writing that I do. So I do the Handbook of Non-Prescription Drugs for APHA. I'm the editor-in-chief of that. And that's quite a little project in and of itself. And then the spinoff of that is I do a monthly column for APHA and Pharmacy Today on self-care and OTCs. I also do some needs assessment writing for a company that delivers continuing education programs. I still do consulting for Lexicomp. I still do monograph reviews for them. So that's part of my overall business. I do inspections of surgery centers for Medicare documentation. So I go in and do those things quarterly for a number of surgery centers in the area. I do the expert witness stuff where I serve as an expert witness for attorneys for different cases. And then I work part-time for a couple different pharmacies in the area. One's a community pharmacy, one's a hospital pharmacy where I do some work for both of them part-time. So I stay pretty busy with a lot of those activities, and they all fall under that Educare umbrella. I'm also a part-time faculty member at the Lake Erie College of Medicine School of Pharmacy. So I do some teaching for them and serve on some committees and advisor work and things like that. And so it all kind of falls in the Educare business because it's all part of either education or patient care. And so that's kind of my little check boxes. So if it's something that I like to do and it falls under one of those two major categories, then I'll try and jump in without getting too overwhelmed.
Wow. That is a lot of stuff under one umbrella. I am in awe, really. And the thing that really stuck out when you talked just now was about the expert witness opportunity that you have. Mm-hmm. Wow. Not every pharmacist does that. Can we talk about that? Because you are truly using your voice, probably on some sort of a stand, certainly giving a written or verbal statement. I just got to dive into that just for a couple minutes. Do you mind?
Sure. So I initially got started in this when I was working in Alabama at UAB as a kinetics pharmacist. Our director of pharmacy was approached by somebody in legal at the hospital who was approached by an attorney who was looking for an expert in drug therapy evaluation. And he had a case where he needed a pharmacist to be able to look at a patient profile and labs and things and be able to determine what was the potential range of the patient's theophylline level based on these factors. And so it ended up in my lab because our director knew that I was in charge of kinetics, and this was more of a kinetics situation. So I ended up meeting with this attorney, and this attorney was a very Southern individual. His name was Fish Herring, if you can believe that. Just really bizarre. Anyway, very unique individual. So he came in, we talked about the case, and he said, if you're interested, we'd like to get you to take a look at this. So they send a box of patient records. I mean, a box of patient records. So you have to go through all these records. And the goal was to determine whether the patient could have had a high enough theophylline level to cause a major seizure. And the patient was on erythromycin. This is back when, you know, we didn't have nearly as many medications at our disposal as we do now. So I looked at, you know, lab data and did all these calculations and had to come up with a document that looked at the what ifs and gave them ranges and all that. And as it turns out, there was a good chance that the patient's aminophylline drip was not titrated correctly based on patient factors and probably contributed to a high enough theophylline level that could have caused the problems that the patient had. But they never checked theophylline levels at this hospital because it was a small community hospital. So anyway, that was my first foray into being an expert witness. At the end of that case, he said, you know, you ought to take your talents and find ways to use them in this area because attorneys are looking for experts that can do this type of work. Okay, fine. Never really thought much about it. Moved back to Ohio. And I think I was at dinner with somebody who worked for a local attorney. And we got to talking about something. And they said, you know, we've got a case where we might need a pharmacist. Okay, let's, you know, get on the phone, have a conversation. So I ended up working that case and looking at, you know, the situation to see whether, you know, there was any negligence on the pharmacist side to see whether it was actually something that was worth pursuing. You know, a lot of the cases that I'm approached to look at, unfortunately, are cases where pharmacists potentially made mistakes or just were not conscientious in the work they did. So I'm representing the plaintiff, which is tough because you're kind of going against people in your own profession. But there's people in our profession that just aren't doing their jobs. And more recently, a lot of the cases that I'm getting are cases that resulted from pharmacists being overworked, not paying attention, and not doing their jobs. And when you look at what the law requires, so here in Ohio, we have what's called prospective DUR, where for every prescription, we're supposed to review the patient's profile prior to final approval, whether it's a newer or refill prescription. Well, if you're doing, you know, 600-700 scripts a day, and you're doing immunizations and you're answering phones, and you know, some of that stuff just doesn't happen. Well, there's situations where when it doesn't happen, people die. And it's unfortunate.
That's terrible. Yeah. But it happens.
Nobody wins. And so my goal, I guess, is to be able to provide perspective and look at what laws, rules, and regulations are on the books and then apply that to the case. But then also to help create awareness from my perspective with our profession to let them know, let my colleagues know, there are situations out there that happen that lead to very bad outcomes when you don't do your job correctly. So take that extra 10 seconds to review the patient's profile. Don't be hesitant to tag a prescription to counsel a patient to get information. Don't hesitate to pull a script back and call the prescriber to clarify information. It could save your patient's life and it could save your career. But more importantly, it's a patient issue. So that's how I got involved in the whole expert witness stuff. And that's kind of the role that I play now. And I've had to give a deposition, which was a very fascinating experience. It was 4.5 hours of being grilled by the defendant's attorney. And
wow,
the defendant is a very large chain pharmacy. So this attorney was, you know, pretty high up and very intense. And he was trying to poke holes in my written testimony as to what I thought happened. You know, he was trying to say that because you're not board certified, you're not qualified to provide an opinion on this. And I don't have a PharmD, so I'm not qualified. And so he was trying to look at ways to put holes in my testimony. But the attorney that I was working with was also on the call. And she came right back in and defended and said, you know, he's got, you know, 37 years of experience. He's got 22 years of experience as a community pharmacist. He knows the laws. He knows standard of practice. His testimony is fine. He's got every right to tell us that this is what is required to happen. This is what should happen. This is what did not happen. And then we see the outcome when it did not happen. But it was pretty intense. I'm actually giving a deposition at the end of February on another case, and we'll see how that goes. But you got to have a backbone when you get into this, because you know the attorneys are going to find any way to make a case for their client so that they don't have to pay and they're not found guilty. And it's difficult. It really is when you see what happens to people when preventable errors take place. You know, all the stuff that I've seen so far is preventable if you just take that extra time to do your job.
Good words of advice, Dan. Thank you.
Sure.
Have you ever been in the courtroom on the stand? Is that what a deposition is like? Or is that
No.
in a private area?
It was in a private area. So I met at this business location. They rented a conference room for the day. And they had the court reporter there who was, you know, doing all the recording of everything. And then I was there, the defendant's attorney was there, and then the attorney I was working with was on the computer screen because she was in Indiana.
Oh, I was just curious what that was like.
Yeah. So. I haven't been on the stand yet. There's a chance because that case where I provided the deposition is still active. I can't believe they haven't settled yet. But I may end up having to go testify. You know, when you have to do that, you have to, you know, be there ahead of time. The attorney has to prep you and get you ready and tell you what to say, what not to say, how to say it, and things like that.
Well, good luck if that happens, Dan. And thank you for the important work you do. I know it's not easy because you often have to, just give the facts, you know, and it's not pretty sometimes what happens to us pharmacists. And I appreciate you being objective and just doing your job.
I know I've made errors in my career, and I remember just about every one of them. I won't say they haunt me to this day, but you don't forget. And it's motivation to me to take those extra steps. You know, I work part-time at a very busy pharmacy, and I'm one that I tell people right away because I float. I'll work with people I've never met before. I'll say, I know you like to keep your queue clean, meaning they don't like to have scripts back up. So when I'm here, there's a good chance things are going to back up. And they back up because I take my time to review every profile for every prescription to make sure that I know what the circumstances are. Is this a dose change? Whatever it is, I want to make sure I understand what's going on. And I tag a lot of prescriptions for counseling. So I'm going to talk to a lot of patients today. And that's very important to me. Again, I have to use my voice. I have to use my knowledge and experience to help people. And if it's a new SSRI and the patient's never been on one before, they need to understand that it's not going to start working with the first dose. And if it's a Medrol dose pack and they're going to pick it up at dinner time, they need to understand if they want to start it tonight, here's how you do it. If they want to wait till the morning, here's how you do it. But that requires counseling, talking to patients. Yes, that's going to make the queue back up. I will take care of that. Don't freak out. Again, you talk about communication, right? You got to communicate with your staff, let them know that you got their back, that you're taking responsibility for things, but we're going to do what's in the best interest of patients. And I've actually seen changes in practice with some of the people I've worked with who've told me, you know what? I now counsel more patients because of what you've done. You've let me know that it's okay to do that, that it's not just taking care of the numbers. So that's been very rewarding to me, is to hear that feedback from some of the people I work with.
You're forever a teacher.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. I've always gone back to teaching and education in academia.
And you really care. And that means something.
And, you know, I go back to what we first talked about with Tom and Janet. You know, they showed me that, you know, they cared about people they worked with, the patients they took care of. And I've been fortunate to work with people over the years that have shown me the value of caring for other people. You know, I get involved every year in a medical mission trip. And that's one of the highlights of what I do every year. That the care that we receive from the people that we care for down there is incredible. And just the love and the compassion and just, you know, it's extremely rewarding to be able to be in that kind of environment, and, you know, to help people. And again, I feel so blessed to have been able to do what I've done and to work with the people I've worked with. And if I can give back in a small way, that's my goal.
I love that you do mission work. I would love to do that. I just can't figure out the caregiver situation so I can get away for that long. But can you tell me which organization or organizations you've worked with for your trips?
So it's through our local Catholic church. And I kind of got involved at the last minute, 17 years ago, when the pharmacist that was supposed to go was ill. And this was in late October. And the trip was in January. Mm-hmm. We didn't have a lot of time to prepare. It was the first time we were going to be going down there. So a chain email was sent out saying, hey, does anybody know of a pharmacist that might be able to go on short notice to Honduras for the mission trip? And one of my buddies called me and said, hey, do you know anybody who might be able to go? I'm thinking, at the time I was working for Lexicomp, so I had a passport because I had just recently been in Singapore. So I had the passport. I could get time off. I called my wife, and I was in Boston at an ACCP meeting, and I said, hey, what are we doing in mid-January? And she said, I don't know, I'm hunkering down because it's cold outside. I'm not going anywhere. I said, well, you know, Deacon Phil can't go on the mission trip. They need a pharmacist. I was thinking about going. So I ended up joining the team, and I've gone every year since. And it's through the Catholic Church, and we've expanded from, I think we had 24 people go the first year. A couple of years ago, we had close to 70 go down. We take a group of high school students that are in the advanced Spanish course that act as interpreters. And then we take doctors, dentists, nurses, optometrists, pharmacists, and just a bunch of people that want to serve. And we go down there for a week, see between 3,000 and 4,000 patients, dispense 15,000 to 20,000 prescriptions, and stay busy, but it's incredible. So we haven't gone the last 2 years because of the pandemic. But we do fundraisers and we send money down there, and then they buy supplies to be able to take it to the villages that we normally serve.
That's amazing.
Again, it's a huge blessing to be able to, you know, use our talents to go down there. It's a wonderful group of people. They're like family. We're best of friends. We stay in touch with people down there who I consider a family. And it's pretty special.
Awesome. Well, I feel terrible segueing away from this beautiful moment, but I also wanted to ask you something. You mentioned Lexicomp was like a family. I want to talk about family and people that feel like family. Can you tell me a little bit about what you meant when you talked about that?
When I worked for Lexicomp, I think I was the 50th employee. And I knew about the company, but I didn't know about the company. And I got started and a few of my former colleagues were already working there. I'd say within the first 30 days, I really felt as though I was part of a family. It was a privately owned business. The owner and his wife both worked there, both intimately involved in the business. The owner and two of his best friends started Lexicomp. They used to work together in some other businesses. And it really had that family feel to it. Just a couple examples of how they created this family environment. So they would take a day off every summer and take everybody in their family to Cedar Point, which is, you know, local, world-renowned amusement park.
It's the best. Park.
It is. And so they'd rent a pavilion. Yeah, I mean, everything was paid for by the company. And it was a company day to build that culture. Every year over the holidays, we would have a family gathering at the corporate office where they would have everybody bring their families in. And the owner and his wife would buy gifts for every kid of every employee of the company. They would also have a family outing where they would take us to downtown Cleveland to a concert or a show. And it was us and our spouses. And again, everything was paid for by the company. They also had a policy where they would hire any employee's kid that needed a summer job.
That's cool.
And that's how both of our boys became best friends with a lot of my friends' kids, and they've been in each other's weddings and we'll be best friends for life. And so it really was an amazing environment there. The family culture, the family feel was just, it's hard to describe, but you really felt special and like you were part of a group that was doing something very special. And it was more than just, you know, the work. I mean, the work was great. We went from being primarily a print publisher when I first started to being primarily an electronic publisher when I left 7 years later. And the company just exploded and just was doing some incredible things. And I think a lot of that was due to the fact that we had that family culture and everybody felt invested in the company and they were willing to do whatever they needed to do to make the company successful.
That's a great story. I love that. And when we were talking at Metapreneurs in October, I think you said you were leaving on the Sunday of the conference to go to some sort of a, I think you called it a family reunion for LexiComp.
It was. Yep. We get together every year or two. Anybody who's in the area, in fact, people have come from all over the country once it's scheduled. And one of our former sales associates, he and his wife now have a microbrewery down in the Green area, which is south of Akron.
Cool.
And we meet there. And it is like a family reunion. You see people you haven't seen in years, catch up with folks, and everybody talks about their kids, their grandkids. We really don't talk much about business. It's just all about the people and how everybody's doing. And it's special to be a part of that. And it's special to have been a part of a company like that.
I agree. I think you have been so lucky to have some of the wonderful experiences that you have. Mm-hmm. And for any company who's got, you know, a CEO listening to this, life goal, that's what you want your employees to feel like, that it is a family and you want to come back and see people and spend your time off with your coworkers. That's something special.
It's unusual, but yeah, we were very lucky to have been in that kind of environment. In fact, Bob Kirscher, who was the owner, who has since passed away, fortunately, one of his best friends was the individual who started Davy Tree. And Davy Tree was an employee-owned company. He developed an ESOP, employee stock ownership program. And so Bob took that concept and he offered stock or ownership to a number of his employees, which worked out great. So we were actually invested in the company and owned part of the company when we were there.
Oh, that's
and
cool.
It really, yeah, gave you that additional sense of pride and ownership and commitment to the mission. And it meant a lot to have been a part of that.
Very cool. I love that story. That's a feel-good story right there.
It was, yeah. Again, I just was very, very fortunate to have been a part of that. The relationships I developed. So some of the people I worked with there were also the shared faculty people I worked with at Northern when I was at Ritzman's that recruited me there. And one of the individuals, Jeff Lewis, he was the dean down at Gregory School of Pharmacy and Palm Beach Atlantic University. He hired me on when I started my new business a couple of years ago to do some work for his experiential team down there for 9 months. Now, Jeff and I are continuing to collaborate on a couple of new business opportunities at this current time. So he's now left the university. He's working with another company and he and I and Sue are collaborating on some things. So yeah, we've continued to keep that common thread going and finding ways to work with people that are very talented and have the same passion and goals.
It's good to connect with people, isn't it?
Yeah. So it's interesting. Jeff and I go way back. So when I was leaving Alabama and looking for a job in Ohio, Jeff was the clinical coordinator at a local hospital in Canton. And that was one of the two jobs I was looking for when I was looking to move back and accept a position. So I called Jeff out of the blue. Again, you know, this is way back before cell phones and the internet. So I somehow found out who Jeff was, and I wanted to find out a little bit about the position, why he was leaving and what he was going into. He never met me before. I'd never met him before. And so I just called him out of the blue and we had a conversation and he shared with me some very valuable information. And he was moving to a local, another hospital in Akron, and he was going to be in a shared position with Ohio Northern. So you talk about coming full circle. When down the road, I was looking to apply for that position with Ohio Northern and Ritzman's, he was at that meeting. And I didn't know what he looked like. When he introduced himself, he said, "Oh, I'm Jeff Lewis." And I said, "You mean the Jeff Lewis that left that position in Canada?" He goes, "Yeah." I said, "I'm Dan. I'm the one that called you out of the blue about that job." So he and I have known each other now for 31 years and have connected through that, through Ohio Northern. We worked together at Ritzman some. We worked together at Lexicom, worked together at Palm Beach Atlantic. And now we're working together in this capacity in this new venture.
That's so cool.
And his boys have gone on vacation with us. In fact, my son was just in his son's wedding a couple of weeks ago.
That's so cool.
He was in Brian's wedding. Yeah, his family's been at both of our kids' weddings. And yeah, it's just, it's great.
That's a deep connection.
And it's all through pharmacy. And that's what pharmacy's done.
Have you ever heard anyone say that the world of pharmacy is kind of a small world?
Oh, yes. It gets smaller every day. It's like the whole Kevin Bacon game. You know, it's the 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. It's 6 degrees of pharmacy. I know somebody who knows somebody who knows that person. Yeah.
Yes. Well, you've had such an amazing career and have used your voice in so many ways. I want to ask you about one final way that you use your voice, and it's not exactly a pharmacy thing, but I'm sure you'll understand. In your career, you have been a dad and now a grandpa, and I am going to be doing a Pharmacist Dads series in the month of June in honor of Father's Day. Is there any advice that you could share with dads or grandpas about having a career in pharmacy and still being present for your family?
Yes. And it's easy to say at this point in my career after having lived it, but my advice is, always put your family first. Always prioritize your family, your kids, your spouse. Keep them as your number one priority. And when you get out of school, you're going to want to focus on your career, develop your career, become whatever it is you want to become, whether it's a director of pharmacy or pharmacy manager, whatever that might be. And that's all fine. But as I got older and maybe wiser and maybe more experienced, I realized that my career is a means to an end to optimize what's going on with my family. So I wanted to have time to coach my kids in sports. I wanted to have time to attend events and be there for the special milestones for your kids and, you know, be able to, you know, go on vacation with the family and, you know, do something with my wife for our anniversary, whatever that might be. You've got to prioritize the family. It's got to be number one. And as a dad, you never get those moments back. You know, I was extremely fortunate when my kids were at an age where they were involved in sports is to be able to be at almost all their events. And I coached both my boys in baseball and basketball, you know, pretty much every summer from when they were 5 years old till they graduated from high school. And I would never sacrifice that in a million years. And so, again, prioritize your family. Career is important. There's no question career is important. But pharmacy is always going to be there. There's always going to be an opportunity to work more. But don't necessarily look at that as something that you should prioritize. It's okay to have downtime. It's okay to just take some time and, you know, read a book with your child or attend, you know, a sporting event or go to the library or whatever it might be. And we do that with our grandkids now. We're fortunate they live 20 minutes away. And so we have them spend the night here, you know, every week or two. And it's just, it's phenomenal to be able to, you know, share time with them and to be with them, and wouldn't trade it for anything.
And you must have done something right because they're still talking to you. Clearly you were there for them. You have a great relationship now. You get to enjoy your grandkids and you get to see everybody still. And you get to have this amazing career.
Yes, I really couldn't ask for anything more.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing that as well. I think there's a lot of young men out there right now who aren't even fathers yet who need to hear the words that you just shared. So thank you.
So I tried to just have sidebar conversations with a lot of the junior faculty guys that were, part of NeoMed when I was there. And Tim Ulbrich.
Yeah.
So Tim started as a faculty member at NeoMed when he graduated from his residency at Ohio State. And Tim started having a family, started having kids. And I kept reminding him, I said, don't miss time with your boys. And he's done a phenomenal job in finding balance between his work and his new business and spending time with his kids. And he's got an amazing family, and I'm so happy for what he's done. And Tim is a great role model for professional dads out there and finding the right balance. And so I would recommend, if you have a chance, to get Tim to talk about that, because he's right in the middle of it. And I think he's got a lot to share as well.
Thank you for that suggestion. He's actually one of the dads I have in mind for the Pharmacist Dad series in June. Good. And I just have not personally asked him yet. I told one of his coworkers about it, Justin, but I did not talk to Tim yet.
Tell Tim I told him he's got to do it.
Okay. I'm going to leave that on the audio so he hears it.
Yes.
Awesome. Thank you. Now, as we wrap this up, is there anything else that you'd like to share?
I think pharmacists really need to take advantage of their platform and advocate for whatever changes they feel are in the best interests of their profession and the best interests of their patients. And I kind of reverse that, patients first and then the profession. I know it's the chicken and the egg thing, but I've always believed that if we do what's in the best interest of our patients, it'll be in the best interest of our profession. So we need to use our voice, have our voice heard at the local, state, and national level to advocate for, again, what we feel is best. I'm a firm believer in getting the masses to try and deliver the consistent message to our legislators, other stakeholders that can be impacted by what we do. But we've got to believe it first. We've got to, walk the walk and talk the talk and do all the things that we should be doing as professionals. And don't hesitate to look in the mirror every so often and ask that person in the mirror if you're truly doing what's in the best interests of your patients and your profession, because we have to answer to ourselves first and foremost. And, we have a responsibility, I think, to, again, try and move things forward and make the next generation of pharmacists have it better than we had it, which is what we try and do as parents, right, is make it better for our kids than what we had. That's why I like to be involved in academia, is to try and get the next generation of pharmacists to have better opportunities than what we had. And it's a great profession. I firmly believe that we have a lot to offer, and I'm excited about our future. I really am.
I'm excited about the next generation as well.
Yes.
Who knows what's going to happen? We'll stay tuned.
Definitely. And pharmacogenomics will be a big part of it. I'm a firm believer of that.
I believe that too. And certain things that haven't even been invented yet will be part of the next generation's future. And we'll be looking on in our retirement and smiling.
When I think about all the change that I've seen over the period of time I've been a pharmacist, going from a typewriter and manual documentation of refills to the technology we have today, and just the advances in healthcare and the training of, healthcare professionals, it's incredible. So yeah, the next 5 to 10 years should be very exciting as well.
Absolutely. Well, Dan, thank you very much, my fellow Ohioan, for being here on the Pharmacist Voice podcast and sharing how you use your voice, especially as a PGX pharmacist here in my PGX Pharmacist series. Take care.
Thank you, Kim. I appreciate the opportunity.
Let me share a few parting comments with you. First, PGX 101 has a training event scheduled for February 26th and 27th, 2022. The PGX 101 LinkedIn page says that the registration closes on February 12th. as I release this on January 28th, 2022, that's not much time. So if you're interested, go to pgx101.com and register today. There's also a link to the training in the show notes in case you're working out or driving or doing dishes and you can't write that down right now. It looks like you need to complete the 12 hours of home study prior to the live portion. Hey, we're all busy, and I'm sure that takes time to complete, so check it out, sign up, and get started on those 12 hours of home study today. Second, I'm going to ask you a question. Do you always feel ready for the jobs that you end up doing? Whether it's putting together a baby's crib, making a TPN by hand, working in the community setting as a pharmacist as a new grad, or becoming the clinical coordinator for the pharmacokinetics service at a university hospital, we aren't always 100% ready to do the job the moment we accept it, right? That's a normal feeling. I like that Dan shared how he felt when he accepted the clinical coordinator role for the pharmacokinetics service at the University of Alabama Hospital. He had a good foundation. He learned a lot, and he made a significant improvement in the lives of patients who previously did not have access to consults and monitoring from his drug resource team. Dan stepped up, and he made good things happen. Just like my husband put together a crib after never having done that before, and I certainly learned how to make TPNs by hand. It's much easier with a machine, though, am I right? Third, I love the gratitude in Dan's comment about wanting to give back to the pharmacy profession because the pharmacy profession has given so much to him. Education is one way to give back and pay it forward, and Dan is definitely an educator. Let's wrap this up. Dan Krinsky has had a long and successful career. After more than 40 years in the profession of pharmacy, Dan still has a lot of gas left in his tank. He is not ready to retire. But when he does, this is a personal comment here, I hope he does buy some land and raise some golden retrievers. And why would I say that? Because in the beginning of our interview, he mentioned that after he graduated with his bachelor's degree in pharmacy, he felt like he had two choices: buying land in Vermont and raising golden retrievers, or going to grad school. Dan, if you're listening to this, I say, why not do both? You already did the grad school thing. When it's your time to retire, I hope golden retrievers are part of your retirement plan. My son had a golden retriever for a therapy dog. His name was Bond, and he was such a good boy. We loved him. Maybe you could even foster therapy dogs. Who knows? But for now, rock on with your pharmacy career, Dan, and thanks again for being my guest. Thank you for listening to episode 133 of the Pharmacist Voice podcast. Please visit thepharmacistvoice.com to read the show notes, links to PGX 101, Educare for You, Dan Krinsky's LinkedIn profile, and more are in those show notes. And one last thing, word of mouth is still a great way to share information. So if you liked this episode, please share it with a friend and subscribe to or follow the Pharmacist Voice podcast in your favorite podcast player to get each new episode delivered to your smartphone every time a new episode comes out. Thank you again for listening.